Welcome to the Faculty Development Center. And today we are talking about branding. And I won't tell you with whom, because you already know, because he's an effective brander. So Dr. Larry Rosen has kindly agreed to come and share with us tools to help us brand ourselves so that we can take our careers to the next level and let people know all of the effective and great things that we are doing. And so, as many of you know, because a lot of you attended last year's section on how to write a book, he's very prolific in his book writing and things like Me, My Space, and Eye Disorder. And they all have this theme which lends itself to effective branding, which he has parlayed into not only just being a professor here, which is fantastic and wonderful, but also a fabulous speaking career. So that takes him all over the world speaking on his research. And branding has been an effective tool to help him do that. And thankfully, he will share those tips and tools with us today. So let us welcome Dr. Larry Rosen.
Thank you. And you will get, I don't like people having copies of the slides when the talk is going on, so you'll get them afterwards, and they're videotaping and everything. I would like to say that I was very purposeful in my own branding and that I knew exactly what I was doing, but that would be a lie. I've been stumbling through this whole process since I started this line of research in 1984. So it's taken me 30 years to effectively brand myself over time. And I sort of, when I suggested to Keisha that I might do this, I sort of said it jokingly. But as I delved into it, I realized that there are a lot of things that you can do to make yourself known. And I will forewarn you that it's not going to take 5 minutes. It's not going to take 30 years. But that it's something that you should be, if you really do want to be something other than an academic, which is really, brand yourself as an academic, but that's a different story, I think. And I'm happy to talk about that, but that's mostly through good research and interesting topics. But I do think that if you want to do anything outside of academia, which I think almost every academic wants to do, that it's worth considering how you present yourself and understanding what a brand is. So please feel free, by the way, to interrupt me at any time. I'm happy with that. So here's what I want to talk about. First, what is branding and how is it different from marketing? Because they are very different, and I will try to go through that and explain to you how that works. What is your unique niche? And I really say, what is your identity? And this doesn't have to be who you see yourself as personally. In fact, my business identity has nothing to do with my personal identity. My personal identity is I hang out a lot, I drink a lot of tequila, I read a lot of trashy novels, I play with my dog. I mean, that's sort of my personal identity. My fiance and I go to lots and lots of movies and film festivals, but that doesn't fit anywhere into my professional identity. My professional, really I don't even call it a professional identity, I call it a business identity because it is a business. And my business identity is, if you look at my website, my business identity was formed probably 20 something years ago in accidentally defining the area that I was talking about, which I jokingly at one point called the psychology of technology. Sounded hip, it sounded cool, it sounded fun. And that's become my brand. And it was an accident, but when I think about it, it's perfect because technology, everything's technology, and people always want to know about psychology. They always want to know what goes in on our heads inside there. What are we thinking? What are we doing? And interestingly enough, there are not a lot of people that do it, which was also a consideration, and I'll talk about that in a bit. But it was sort of an accidental identity, and now what it does is it affords me to write books, to do media interviews, to consult, to do all sorts of things that I never would have thought I had a chance. I thought I was just going to be a professor and just become old and retire and have a pension. And that is great, but because of my identity, because not being a professor, I've gotten to travel all over the world. I've got invited to speak. I've been in India 3 times. I've been in Spain. I've been in Hong Kong. I've been in Canada a million times. I've been all over the world, and it's only because of the brand. I don't think it's because of anything else at all. So I'm going to talk about that. I'm going to talk about how you can position yourself, and it's a process. And again, I can talk from mistakes. I can tell you all the mistakes I've made and how to not do those. And then I'm going to end with what I think is a step-by-step plan of how to do this. And by the way, this is all just came to me. When Keisha and I talked about branding as a concept, I didn't really know what the hell I was going to talk about. And I thought, well, maybe I'll show some stuff that I've done and how it fits, and I don't want to do any of that stuff. What I want to do is try to give you a step-by-step plan. It's a long-term plan, but it's a step-by-step plan. So, first of all, these are all brands. Anybody read Sue Grafton? Even if you don't read, anybody know Sue Grafton? She wrote the A is for, B is for, C is for, that is a brand. That is her specific brand. You know Tim Ferriss? Tim Ferriss writes the 4-hour, 4-day, everything. He is the champion of the 4 such and such. Fabulously wealthy author. 50 Shades of Grey. Again, a brand. These are all book brands. How about that brand? Everybody know that? You don't even need the word there, right? Everybody knows. Target. How about that one?
Shell.
Shell. Everybody knows that. How about that one?
Windows,
Microsoft. And of course, Apple. These are all brands. And the idea of a brand, I think on the basic level, is to have somebody see something or hear something, and the first thing they think of is you. And it takes a microsecond to think of you. What do you think of?
BMW.
KFC.
KFC.
Rolades,
an old brand. Now that's an interesting one because in my mind this is a dual one. This is both a saying and a visual. And both of those are so well-known brands that this is what you see. Remember that one? Don't see that much anymore.
Avis.
Avis. Avis. And how about this one?
Oh,
I pulled that from an old. I pulled that from an old one, Clairol.
Yeah.
Does she or doesn't she color her hair?
Yeah.
But these are all, again, these did not come from nowhere. People, they cultivated it. They hired lots of PR firms. They test these things. And what they eventually try to do is to have you be associated with either your words or your picture or something. So why should you ever brand yourself? My question, and this is the question anybody ever talks to me about this, I ask them, don't worry about branding yourself as an academic. Does anybody want to just brand themselves as an academic? I don't think so. It's not worth it. You're not going to get any better salary. You might get some fame and some ego boost, but you're better off getting that with some money also. And I figure the reason you want to brand yourself is you'd like to make some extra money. You'd like to have a life outside of academia and maybe even move out of academia completely. So, number one is write a book. How many people want to or have written a book? Okay. How about become a consulting expert? How many people would like to become a consulting expert? Okay. How about become a paid speaker? That's a really, really good one, by the way. We'll talk about that. But of all of these, this is the only one where you'll make a lot of money. If your goal is to make a lot of money, which is this one, how many people would just like to make a lot of money? Good to see some academics want to admit that they want to make money. It is a way of life. Get famous. How many people would just like to be famous? Me. Nobody else? I mean, I like that my name, that people know me. It kind of feels good, and that's enhancing your ego, and I won't ask you if you want to enhance your ego, but I suspect that all of these have to do, on some level, with enhancing your ego, feeling better about yourself, feeling successful. And so the bottom line is you need to figure out what it is you want to do. How, what is your root? And I think that's really step one, is what is your root? What do you want to do? If it's not on this list, I don't know what it could be, but I thought that was pretty exhausting. Anybody want to do anything else to brand yourself? No? Okay, that's kind of what I figured. These seem to cover it. For all of these things, there's two things you need to know, and I'll try to go through them and tell you my theory of them. I'm not an expert, obviously, in any of this stuff. I stumble into most everything I do. But basically, you need to know how to define yourself and then how to market yourself. And those are very separate kind of things. Branding is not marketing. Marketing is very different. We'll talk about that. But branding is really building your long-term identity. And this takes some time, because the first thing you need to do is figure out who you are. What identity do you want? What would you like to be? And it goes back to that list before. You need to kind of figure out what you would like to be. And I always tell people when they ask me, say, Matt, you're a professor now or on campus now, and you want to be something else. What would you want to be in 1 year? What would you want to be in 5 years? What would you want to be in 10 years? And you should always be thinking ahead about what you would like to be. I think having a one-year plan is great. Don't expect to brand yourself completely in 1 year. I think a five-year plan is more appropriate. That if you can brand yourself across as a process across 5 years, that in 5 years you can be wherever you define that you want to be, which is what you want to be and where you want to be. What you really are looking for is a clear picture of you. And I think it's interesting because I have met a lot of brilliant academics, and a very small portion of them are even marginally good at branding themselves and finding an identity. I just went to a conference that brought all of the best people in my area, and the conference was talking about multitasking, and I consider that one of my branded areas. Multitasking, and there were about 100 people, all of whom, it's like I'd see their name tags and go, oh, I know you, I know you, I know you. I knew everybody's name, never met any of them. I would say that of those great academics, say 100 academics, that there were maybe only 20 who I would identify as having a brand. And the interesting one was the most famous one. How many people know who Sherry Turkle is? Sherry Turkle is a professor at MIT. She's an odd conglomerate. I think she was originally trained as a psychoanalyst in Paris. She was at MIT in their media studies department. And then she wrote a book. And she wrote a book, and then she wrote another book. And then she wrote another book. And then she wrote another book. And now when you think about, at least in a picture, she now commands five-figure speeches. She waltzed in, gave the major speech at the conference, got $10,000 for it, I asked, and left. That was it. And her brand is she can talk about technology and how psychologically we deal with technology. Luckily, she doesn't use my psychology and technology term. She doesn't need it. She's got her own brand. And her brand is her understanding of technology and how psychology wraps around that, and everybody knows that. And in general, if you look at many of the interviews that I do, the two of us are both interviewed in the same. So we sort of have an overlapping brand. She's much better at it than I am, and I give her a lot of credit for that. I don't like her books, by the way, but she's much better.
Why is she better? Why is she better?
She's better because I don't know. She's better because she's been more successful at it.
Longer?
No, her first book came out right when my first book came out, in the mid-90s. I think she started branding herself a lot earlier than I did. I think that's it, and she's got a certain large persona. She's got the MIT label. But I think she just did a better job.
Mm-hmm.
I think she's just really good at it. There's a lot of people out there who have done a much better job than I have at branding. But if you look at her life, she has done zero research. Zero research.
And MIT kept her?
And she's famous. Of course they kept her. She's very famous. Her books sell 50 to 100,000 copies each.
Mm.
My best selling book is probably 25,000 copies. So that should tell you that's obviously a better brand. And her brand is very consistent, although she's evolved, and I want to talk about this. She's evolved her thinking over time. Her first two books were very positive. It was about how we were approaching technology and the interesting things. And her last two books have been negative and burdensome. Mm-hmm. And I think that was intentional, because she saw the promise of technology and jumped on that brand. And then as we started, she wrote a book called Alone Together, How We Don't Talk to Each Other Anymore. Mm-hmm. And that one recognized that we were missing out on something. So I just think she's done a better job. And she's had better publishers. Simon and Schuster, most of them publishes their book, which helps. So back to the book talk. So your brand is really a promise from you to your audience. And I thought about, when I wrote this out there, I thought, yeah, because my audience, if I go somewhere, know what I'm going to talk about. In many cases, and I'll talk to you about the website and the value of this, in many cases, they've seen me talk before. If they haven't seen me talk live, they've seen me talk because I put some of my talks on my website so they can get a taste of my brand. It's also a sense of trust, and the trust is really the same issue. They know that if they pay you for your brand, they know what they're going to get. So book publishers know, for example, that if they pay me for my brand, they know what they're going to get. They're not going to be surprised. They're not going to get something that they don't want. Speaking engagements, they pay me for my brand. Media interviews, they pay me for my brand. They don't pay anything, but they keep me in business. And then the important thing is, you really are moving from an academic to an entrepreneur. And you have to really think of yourself. It's very hard for academics to do this. We have to think of ourselves no longer as academics, but we are entrepreneurs. We are trying to make money. That is the point of branding yourself. If you just want to brand yourself from fame, that's fine. If you get ego strokes and you want to feel really good about yourself, that's great. I don't think that's the purpose of branding. I think the purpose of branding is to break out of an academic mold and become someone that people want to pay money to hear what they have to say. Okay? If you don't, we'll still talk about some other ways to brand yourself and your identity, but I don't think that it should be your major focus. Marketing is very different. You market your brand. Okay? And the brand is the important thing. And too many times I talk to academics who, it's kind of interesting, I go to Congress, I don't think of myself as very well known. I don't know why, I just don't. It's part of my mother in talking to me, I'm sure, somewhere in my head. But I do know that everybody knows my brand, and that's what's interesting. So if I go to a conference, people come up and ask me, so what are you working on now? What new book? What new this? What area? If all of a sudden I told them I was working on a book on a mystery novel, they'd probably look askance at me. Like, that's not your brand. That's not what you do. It's not your identity. And my identity is pretty clear cut. I write books about the impact of technology. I write about the psychology of technology, and I've squeaked it into multiple different formats. I've talked about techno-stress, I've talked about social media, I've talked about multitasking, but they all surround the same brand, and everybody knows what they mean. This is my brand. I must feel like I should wear it on my name tag. There are other people in my field that have a brand. There's one woman, she's got the best brand in the world. You probably don't even know who she is. Kimberly Young. Anybody know that name? Kimberly Young, in 1995, created the Internet Addiction Test. It's a terrible test. It is an awful measurement tool. It is still used by thousands and thousands and thousands of people every year. She's parlayed it into three books. She's parlayed it into a clinic where she treats people who have internet addiction. And she has done nothing, no research at all. But she's taken the jump from being purely an academic teaching to, wow, got this measurement tool. That was her first and only research project. Got this measurement tool. She publishes it online. She encouraged people to use it for free. When you think of the phrase internet addiction, Kimberly Young is right there. And in fact, the way you can tell is if you search on Google and just type in internet addiction, you will find Kimberly's name first. That's branding. That's exactly branding. So the first thing you have to do is figure out who you are. And quite honestly, don't be surprised if you don't know who you are out there. I think you need to search yourself. I know that's antithetical to being an academic. We're not supposed to have the ego involved in this. But quite honestly, I set up Google Alerts on myself and on various topics all the time. You should get online and figure out what is known about you everywhere. And I don't just mean go on Google, go on 123 people and find all the pictures out there of you. Go on every search engine possible to find out what is out there about you. What do people already know about you? That's important. And then find other people in your field and look to see what's known about them. I constantly search people in my field to see if there's some other way they're marketing themselves, some other niche they found. I think it's important. In my moments of free time, I will sit with my daughter on my lap and go on Google and I'll search Sherry Turkle and see what new interviews she's done, what new things she's doing. It helps me understand how she's modifying her identity and her niche and moving herself as she gets older. You need to communicate your brand, and I'm going to give you a bunch of ways to communicate your brand. I'm going to probably upset some of you because I'm going to tell you that it's not what you think you're supposed to do. And then you need to manage your brand. And this is the important thing. A lot of people just think they come up with a brand, here it is, I hire somebody, which by the way, I never recommend you. Hire somebody to help you develop your brand, and then that's your brand forever. It's not. First of all, you should be the only one developing your brand. Don't listen to PR people, don't listen to marketing people. Talk to your colleagues. What do they think your brand is? What do they think you're an expert in? What do they think your specialties are? And then you need to evolve that brand, because if you keep that brand, the world goes by you. And just the only one I've ever seen to keep her brand is Kimberly, and she's done it because internet addiction has outlasted every other topic in the field, and people still talk about internet addiction, and they will continue to as long as we carry these devices in our pockets that make us addicted. Sherry Turkle changes her brand every few years by publishing a new book with a new side area that she's exploring. I've been sort of modeling mine after her, and my books and my speaking has morphed over time because I originally talked about things like technophobia and technostress and computer phobia and things like that. That was sort of my early brand. And that stuff's passe. Nobody gives a shit about that stuff at all. Nobody really cares. So then social media came in and I tried to change my brand to social media. Poor book title, by the way, Me, MySpace, and I. That would have been great if MySpace is still around and doing anything, but it's gone, which is fine. And then I kind of pulled in education, thinking, well, we're looking at education, so I wrote Rewired, which talked about rewiring education, but again, from the psychological point of view. Then I realized we were all getting crazy, so I wrote I Disorder to talk about why it's making us crazy. And now, at least in my mind, the most popular theme is why we can't focus for more than 5 seconds. And so my latest and probably last book is called The Distracted Mind. And it'll be all about why we get distracted so much, why, what you can do to make yourself healthier again. So I've kind of taken my brand, and it's not, I haven't really moved. I mean, I haven't made this like big quantum jump to something else. I just sort of tweaked it a little along the way and added in really expertise. But you notice that they all fit right around psychology and technology. It all has to do with technology, it all has to do with psychology. So it's within the brand. So the idea is you find what your brand is now, what you've done in the past, and what other people have done to give you ideas, and then what you do is spend time thinking about how to continually move that as your world goes. I've been getting very interested in brain science, and I was willing to be a medical doctor, just couldn't cut the chemistry stuff. And but I've done a lot of thinking about brain science. My co-author for my last book is a neuroscientist, and he's writing about the neuroscience of distraction. And so I now sort of see things through brain science. So I want to just give you what I think is the way our brains work and how you need to consider yourself a little worm getting into somebody's brain. So when information comes in, it comes in through your senses. Mostly our eyes and our ears, but other senses too. The first stop is right up here in the front of your brain. And it's really important from a branding point of view to recognize that, because the first stop is the part of the brain that makes executive decisions. It thinks about things, it pays attention, it works on problems in your head, it decides whether you're going to be impulsive or not, it decides whether you're going to multitask or not, it decides where to put that attention. Well, your idea is that first stop should be you. The attention should be you. And the way you know it's you is because the second stop is it starts getting material from other parts of your brain and pulling it in to make decisions. It really gets it from two places, the emotional center, the amygdala mostly, and the memory center, the hippocampus. And if I can help you understand that, I think that will help you understand brands. Because if, for example, somebody sees my name, they see Larry Rosen. By the way, there are four much more famous Larry Rosens out there. Mm-hmm. So when I Google myself, I have to say minus this and minus this and minus this so I don't get stuff on them. But if somebody in the psychology or education field hears my name, what I want them to do is to bring in things from their memory and their emotions. And from memory, my brand says, this dude knows a lot about the impact of technology on everything. That's what he knows, and that should come from memory, because they've read articles that I've written, they've read other things, and I'll teach you how to do this. But from emotions, what I want them to think of is an emotional reaction to me. And part of my brand has to do with the way I present myself. I'm usually seen as smart, but very irreverent, and I like that brand. And I want that emotional part to hit them. I want them to see Larry Rosen, oh, he knows a lot about technology. Oh, he's kind of funny, he shows comic strips, he's kind of irreverent, but he knows what he's talking about, and he gives us a lot of information. So I want to hit both the emotions and the memory so that they combine together in somebody's brain, and that's how they put it all together. Now, the interesting thing is what we know about the brain is that you don't just put it all together, you embellish it in your brain. So I want them to embellish my brand. I want them to know my brand and build it up, even if it's bull that they're building up. I want them to build up my brand based on what's inside their memory. So that means I have to figure out ways to get into their memory. I gotta get past this front part where they're just sort of paying attention to me and get back here where their memory of me is, and then get inside where their emotional response to me is. Show you how to do that. Takes time, often gets derailed, you really need to repeat it a lot, and that will come when I talk about media and why it's so important. Your goal is to get your message to the whole brain so that the brain expects something from you. When Sherry Turkle's there, they expect something from her. They know what they're going to get. So, what's your future brand? The first question is, what do you want to be? I always say, what do you want to be when you grow up? I'm still working on that, which is true. I'm still working on what I want to be when I grow up. Right now, I'm sort of in a transition, a brand transition as a FERT. So my brand is less my teaching, and I'm trying to transition my brand into something that fits more as I get older. What are your goals? And that goes way back to that very first or second slide. Where do you want to be? And you really do have to put some thought into that, and I'm happy to talk with anybody if you want to know the pluses and minuses of any of those things, because I've tried them all. Some of them worked for me, some of them didn't, some of them worked for you. We were talking about being an expert witness before. That's a really good thing to do. It's very lucrative. You get a crap load of money. It's very high stress. And it's very iffy. So we can talk about, if you want to try to talk through some of the issues of identity, I'm happy to help you with what I know or to get you onto somebody who might know more. Why are you special? Why are you unique? And you need to have something unique about you. It doesn't matter what it is, and it doesn't even matter if it's academic. What matters is that you feel you are special, and you feel you are unique, and that's really, really critical. You may have to lie to yourself, because my experience with academicians is they don't often feel unique, they don't often feel really highly skilled except in teaching. They don't think beyond the world of academia, and you may feel you're unique in academia, you get good teacher ratings, you get awards on campus, that's great. You have your sort of academic brand. You don't need to hear any of this other stuff because it has nothing to do with your academic brand. You need some sort of specialty outside of your academic brand. What do you have to offer? What can you offer? And that's different because can you offer consulting? Can you help people figure out how to do things? Can you offer talking to different groups of people? Can you offer writing books to an audience of people? What is it that you can offer? If you're not a good writer, then you're never going to write a book. If you don't like to read, you're probably never going to write a book, because the best part of writing is reading and figuring out how good writers write. But if you're good at speaking, which quite honestly, most academics, if we have one skill, it's speaking. We can do a lot of it. Maybe that's what you want to do, is speak and get paid for it above and beyond your salary. So this is really important. To find out what you have to offer, you need to find out what's out there about you. So you need to start searching. You need to go and set Google alerts. And I'll talk a little bit about that later, but you need to set Google alerts on yourself. Alerts.google.com. Put in your name in quotes and tell it to send it to you once a week, once every day, whatever. You need to know what's out there. That will help you maybe see how other people see you as unique. Search yourself, find out what other people say. What do you want to be, what do you want out there about you? What do you want on the web to show about you? You can make that happen. It's actually pretty easy to make that happen. So you need to set yourself apart from everybody else. My brand, interesting enough, Sherry Turkle and I came up around the same time. We wrote our first books together at the same time. She did her brand different than mine. And probably I set my brand in spite of what she did, in contrast to what she did. Because she was doing well taking it one direction. I wanted to do well taking it in another direction. I did not want to be competing with her because she's much better looking than I am. And had much better selling books. I mean, that's the bottom line, that helps her brand. So your identity is both static, it's who you are, but it's also dynamic. And if you don't keep changing your identity, your brand kind of fizzles, sadly. So here's how you position it, and to me this is the important part. First thing first is you have to know your identity. And again, I encourage you to take some time to think about this. Do some searching. Ask yourself inside your soul, what is it that's special about you? And when you ask that, maybe even list, here's the special things that I do. Here's the special research I've done. Here's the special speaking I've done. Here's the special this. Then on the right-hand side of the paper, ask yourself how sexy this would be if somebody was interviewing you in the media. Because even though the word sexy isn't showing anywhere in my slides, sexy is the most important thing. And I don't mean sexy like sexual. I mean sexy like hot, like interesting, like fun. If you said you were your expertise was in Mesopotamian architecture, I would say, what's sexy about that? Find something sexy about that. There is something sexy in Mesopotamian architecture. There's some really interesting stories that you can pull and find a niche there. But you got to pull the fun stuff. As academics, we want to talk about, you know, the academic stuff, and that's not sexy, not at all. So it's got to be that way. Number two, you need a website. And how many of you have a personal website? Did you build your own?
No.
Good for you. Did you build your own? Okay, bad for you. Do you have one, Tom?
Yeah, I built my own.
You built your own too?
I need help.
Yeah. Okay, so I built my own first website, and I felt so proud that I was doing coding and I knew how to do this stuff. And one day my daughter, who was about 15 at that time, she's now 26, came to me and said, "Daddy, I have to be honest with you. Your website really sucks." She said, "You really need to get a better website because I can't find anything on your website. It's crowded with everything in the world. I know you want to tell everybody everything you do and everything that you think is important, but nobody can find anything on your webpage." My first page scrolled down and down and down and down. You tried to print my front page, it would take like 20 pages to print my front page. So I ended up hiring somebody to do it. And I never looked back because I think that it makes much more sense to have somebody who knows how to present things do it right. The rule he taught me is that the important stuff should be on the main screen. You should not have to scroll for anything that isn't important, and your brand should be on the front screen and on every screen possible. And I'm not going to show you my website. You can go look at it. It's fine. But it basically is my brand. It talks about what I am, and it talks about the important stuff on the top of each page. Mm-hmm. If you're going to build one, WordPress is a pretty good base. It's pretty easy to build one. It's also easy for experts to help you fix one, because everybody knows WordPress. And it's also easy to modify. Even though I had an expert do my page, unless it's something complicated, I add to it myself. I do the real simple stuff. And then, like, if I have a new book come out, he adds a whole new column, a whole new section for the new book, or anything that I can't do, he does. It makes it better and more readable. You also need a good domain name. Does anybody have a domain, private domain? Good for you. Two private domains. Whois is my go-to. If you go to whois.net, you basically can search for domain names. And it'll tell you if the domain name you want is already taken and who has it and when it expires. It'll tell you often you can buy that domain name for $5,000 from some company. But what you want is a domain name that says your brand. That's it. And my domain name, my first domain name was memyspaceandi.com. That sucked. Because it didn't say anything about my brand. And when I started thinking about what to call my domain name, I had to think, what is my brand? My brand is me. So my domain name is drlarryrosen.com. Kimberly Young's domain name is not kimberlyyoung.com, it's internetaddictionsomething.com, because that's her brand. I don't know if Sherry Turkle has a website anymore, I haven't seen it in a while. But again, if you want to see what people, how people brand themselves, go to some of these famous people and look at their domain names, see what they pick. Some will pick their own name, some out of ego, but some out of that's their brand. It's important. Anyway, Whois is really easy, and domain names are super cheap. I think on Whois you could buy a domain name for like $5 a year or something. Oh, and buy it for a long time. Don't buy it for 1 year. Buy it for 5 years. If nothing else, you're saying to yourself, I'm going to be around for 5 years doing this. And that's important. It's a statement. Media. Media is the most important way to get your brand marketed. And what media means is somebody interviews you and puts your name and your quotes in some form of media. It can be anything. It can be local newspapers, it can be magazines, it can be throwaways, it can be on websites, it can be anything. I have an ironclad 5-minute rule. I email any journalist for any media outlet back in 5 minutes or less. 5 minutes, and that's my 5-minute rule. In fact, if you don't remember anything else, this is the most important thing.
You mean that's if they've commented on your name?
If a reporter emails me and says, "Reporter interested, I got one this morning, interested in a comment on something." And if you have a brand, they will contact you to ask you about your, comment on psychology and technology. I could ask on the weirdest topics. Doesn't matter, they're all under that same brand umbrella. I email them back in 5 minutes with one of two things. Glad to chat with you. Happy to chat with you. I try to make it a little informal. Happy to chat with you. What's your time frame? When do you need to talk to me? Let's make it happen. And then I always try, because this is just me and my personality, I try to make a unique closing to my email. Have I ever written you? I don't think I wrote you closing because I know you too well. My closing is always best or all best from sunny San Diego. Because it's always sunny anyway. It's not a lie. And people recognize that. I emailed somebody the other day and he goes, I didn't remember your name, but I remembered you always end yours with all best from sunny San Diego. So it's like it's always sunny in Philadelphia. That just turns out to be part of my brand. Part of my brand is they know where I live. They know I have a positive mood. But 5 minutes or less, and it does not matter who the reporter is. I think people who want to create a brand underestimate the value of getting into the Daily Breeze, for example, or getting into the Christian Science Monitor, which I don't think exists anymore, or even getting into the National Enquirer. I was in the National Enquirer once. Title of the article was Billions Gripped by Bizarre Phobia. And I thought, first of all, that was really weird, and a lot of my colleagues said, why did you do that? I got 3 speaking engagements out of that one interview. They said, we saw you in the National Enquirer, it sounded fascinating, can you come talk to us? So you just never know where you're gonna get something from. I also respond to all high school journals. I respond to all college journals. I get a lot of those, I probably get 3 of those a week. I respond to all kids who say, you know, I'd like to ask you a few questions. I'm limited, I say I'll take 3 to 4 questions and give you your deadline. Why do I do that? Because I responded to an 8th grader once, 25 years ago, and his father hired me to give a talk. Mm-hmm. You just never know, it's 5 minutes of your time. Respond to everybody. If you're too big to respond to everybody, get somebody to help you and respond for you. But respond to everybody, 5 minute rule. Never say no. And there are times that we'll say no. I'll say no if it's in opposition to my brand, if I don't want, think it's good for my brand. So for example, I was asked the other day to comment on the Virginia Tech issue where the person was on, she was beaten to death or stabbed to death by these two people, but she was contacted on Kik, which is like Yik Yak, which is an anonymous website that you can say nasty shit to people and get away with it. I said, very politely, I said, I'm sorry, this is, and you should take this quote, this is out of my area of expertise. I don't feel comfortable commenting on things that are not my area of expertise. And then I always say, if I turn something down, I always say, but please keep me in your Rolodex for future interviews. Because even though there's no such thing as a Rolodex anymore, they have a Rolodex. Whatever version of it they use, they all have a Rolodex. The reason, by the way, 5 minutes, is because if you don't respond in 5 minutes, they go to the Rolodex and take the next expert in that area, and the next, and the next, and the next. And in fact, in all likelihood, they have already emailed the top 5 experts in the area and are waiting for them to come back. If you're first, you get quoted. Yes?
Can you elaborate on why that example was in opposition to your brand?
I try not to talk about about stuff I don't know much about. I mean, that's unusual, I guess. I don't know much about Kik or Yik Yak, other than I've heard about them. I read about them and they made me feel uncomfortable to talk about them. If I had talked about them, I don't think they would have liked my quote.
Yeah.
Because I would have said something like, this is what happens when you don't have context behind a screen, which I probably could have said. It felt uncomfortable at the moment. And so I just decided it just didn't seem right, like the right venue. It also seemed like they were looking for something. I want you to talk about how awful this is and blah, blah, blah. And it just didn't seem like it was me.
What if you were teaching that day and you can't checked the email.
Oh, I checked my email right after class and right before class.
But so it might be more than 5 minutes, it could be an hour.
Yeah, but as soon as, really the 5 minute rule is as soon as feasible.
Okay,
as soon as you can do it. And trust me, if you wait for an hour, you may lose that interview. You may, but it won't be the first, and if you have a good brand, it won't, certainly won't be the last. But yeah, and check your spam folder, by the way. Check your quarantine folder. You know, we have a quarantine, isq.csudh.edu. Did you guys know that?
No.
isq.csudh.edu. It quarantines, on my account, it quarantines about 50 emails a day. And every once in a while, there's something in there that slips into the quarantine. And often they're from reporters, because they send to a lot of people. Oftentimes, things that get sent to huge lists get stuck in your quarantine. ISQ. Local, start with local print. Talk to our PR, who's our PR person on campus? Talk to Amy Bentley Smith. Tell her you want to get interviewed. Tell her what you'd like to get interviewed on. Start with the local papers. It helps. I was in the Daily Brief so many times I can't remember. I was in La Opinion. I was in, what's this, the Japanese newspaper? I was in the local Japanese newspaper. I did tons of those. Also, practice your messages. Oh, by the way, in terms, I don't know if I said this, in terms of media exposure also, oh, I think this is on another slide, but do a lot of local kinds of things. Go to Rotary Clubs. Rotary Clubs love to hear you speak. Go to Rotary Clubs, practice your speaking. Go to the Elks Club. Go to all these things where you aren't gonna get paid. You're not gonna get a penny for doing these. I think my first, I must have done 10 free speeches before I got one, and that was $250, I'll never forget, $250 for that speech. Practice your messages. You need a message that says your brand, and you need a variety. I have a 10-second, a 30-second, a 1-minute, and a 2-minute.
What do you mean by that? Your phone message, or what?
No, your message, your brand message.
Your point.
My point. Somebody will say, if somebody asks my brand is talking about distraction, let's say. So, Dr. Rosen, why do we get distracted so much? I'd have a 10-second, I'd have a 30-second, I'd have a minute, and a 2-minute. And you should practice those so they're fluid, but you can also flip words in and out. You don't want to say the same thing. You don't want to be Marco Rubio getting in trouble for saying the same thing verbatim over and over. But what you want to do is practice it so it's part of your brain. It's in there. You can pull it out easily. Practice your voice. Oh, the worst, you know these people, these experts that get on and they talk like this and they don't, no, you can't do that. You have to raise your voice, you have to lower your voice. You have to pause for inflections. If you're not good at it, talk to somebody about getting a speech class. You need to be, if you're going to be speaking out there, you need to be interesting. See, didn't you pay attention when I said? Interesting. All I did was just do that with my hands and my voice. You get your audience with your voice, but if your voice is monotone, then people are going to be bored all day long. And then vary your words. You should know a lot of different ways to say exactly the same thing, because you don't want to be quoted by the same people all the time. Speaking. Free structure. Don't make any, you aren't going to make any money for a long time. Don't expect to make money. You need to do a lot of freebies, Rotary Clubs. There are speakers bureaus out there. If you have a really sexy topic, go online, look at speakers bureaus. I have never gotten a job from a speaker bureau ever, and I'm sure I'm listed on several of them. Give away a lot of stuff. Your first few speeches, your first 10, 20, give them away. If they offer you $200, great, say thank you so graciously. You will work up eventually if your brand is a good one, is interesting, is things that people want to see. Oh, also, before I forget, if at all possible, have somebody film all of your speeches. Even if you have to bring a friend with a video camera, have them film all of your speeches. Two reasons. One, because you can put it on your website, or clips on your website. But more importantly, you can watch how you come across. And be your best critic. Online presence. People just want to jump into social media. Don't do it. Social media should come last. What you want to do is establish a slow online presence. I recommend you start by going on, find articles that people write in newspapers, look at the New York Times, look at Boston Globe, look at the major newspapers, register for them, that allows you to comment, and when somebody writes a story on an area in your brand, in your identity, write a comment. On your comment, be positive, don't be argumentative, and leave your contact information. If you'd like any more information, here's my email address, here's my website. You'd be surprised how much you get from that. I still do that. I still go on, an article comes up, I comment. If somebody quotes me in an article online, I put a comment. I say, thank you very much for the quotes, and here's a little more information. Again, you're building yourself up. If you can blog, if you like blogging, there's lots of areas to blog in. You can just start your own blog. It's free. Blogspot is the most common, but there are other blogging platforms. Blogspot is where I started. I still have some sort of stupid blog on there that I can't get rid of. But if there's areas in your expertise, like my expertise, for example, Psychology Today is a big website. And so I asked if I could be a Psychology Today blogger. And I don't write often, but again, it gets you out there. You get your thoughts out there. Social media. Social media is can be a little disastrous because social media spreads so quickly. So I recommend that you spend a lot of time reading and following people and seeing how they milk their brand. You better believe that politicians, try following politicians right now. They are milking their brand for everything they can. Where? It's less on Facebook. Much more right now, it seems Twitter and Instagram are the biggest brand locations. But get a Twitter account, but don't tweet anything until you're really sure that you understand how the whole game works and how you can best present your brand in 140 characters or less. Themes to bear in mind, and these are just sort of summaries. You need a clear, transparent identity. People need to know who you are, what it is you do, what makes you unique. It does take a lot of effort. Don't expect to brand yourself in a year. I would give yourself, like I said, a 5-year plan would be best. It takes time. You have to be changeable. It has to be consistent across everything you do. I don't comment on anything other than my brand online, except for my kids. They're selling pictures. So here's step by step. Just in case you want a nice step-by-step takeaway. Number one, develop and define your unique identity. That's number one step. You have to do that. Take a long time to do it, figure it out. Delineate your audience. Who is it that your identity is important to? Is it to everybody? Is it to marketing people? Is it to educators? Who is your brand important to? Refine the immediate perception you want for your audience. That comes from seeing how you are already perceived out there and making sure that you're perceived the way you want to. Commenting helps. Be surprised how many people read the New York Times comments. They're one of the highest read things on the web. You know, New York Times article comments, 150 comments on them. See how you're perceived. Check your current online persona. Who are you online now? You can't get rid of stuff, but you can certainly overwhelm it with more positive stuff. See who your competitors are. I'm not kidding. I spent a lot of time looking up Sherry Turkle. She's my direct competitor. She and I are probably the most quoted people in this area. And I spent a lot of time watching what she does. I think she's very smart. Don't like necessarily what she says, but she's found some really good identity brand for her. And it works because she's selling books and a ton of money. Develop your own themes and messages. And again, these are dynamic. Create short and long-term plans. This is really important. You should have a 6-month plan, a 1-year, 5-year, and 10-year plan. I started mine, and when I started, my 10-year plan was I wanted to travel the world for free. I wanted people to pay me to travel the world. It took me way more than 10 years to get up to there. But I did get a lot of trips to a lot of really neat places. I got to take my kids a couple times. And it was my 10-year plan. Don't be afraid to post those plans. I have a bulletin board, a pin board right behind my computer. And I have lists of things that have to do with my brand, things to remember to do. Don't be afraid to post your plans. And don't be afraid to change them. take steps to display your brand, and then you have to continue to constantly monitor and refresh it. You, by the way, if you're creating your own brand, you should be on the web all the time looking yourself up. I know that sounds very egocentric, but anytime there's an article about you, you're quoted in an article, there's something of interest to you, your name shows up someplace, you need to be on top of that. You need to know, because this is an era where people know about you only from what you are online. Very few people know you personally, but they build up their perception of your brand from what's online. And I think that's it. Thank you.